between describing her as an air hostess and calling her an air hostess. The example was rather typical, it's flatness, the notion of an air hostess. I couldn't see any difference at all, and he was very... But he was introducing these long lists, which is quite different from Wittgenstein, quite different from Weizmann, and different again from Ryle.
Austin invented the term performative to refer to certain utterances which cannot be said to be true or false in the ordinary sense, because they constitute an action rather than report a fact. For example, if you promise to do something, it's rather like naming a ship or baptizing a child. You can do it happily or unhappily, Austin used to say. That is, you can fulfill the action or you can fail to fulfill it. Austin died in 1960. There's one recording of him lecturing that survives. It was made by an amateur at a lecture in Göteborg a year before Austin's death. The quality is poor, but here's an excerpt from it.
Even in ceremonies or rituals that are not verbal at all, we have devices which in just the same way make explicit what act is being performed. For example, supposing I appear before you and bow deeply from the waist. It may be quite uncertain what I am doing. I may be simply bending down to observe the flowers or to tie my shoelace. But it's possible that what I am doing is some form of obeisance to you, some form of homage. Now, in order to clear up this unfortunate kind of ambiguity, we usually invent some little device such as raising our hat or saying salam with which to accompany the bow and by means of which to make our act explicitly and unambiguously one of doing obeisance or homage. Nobody would wish to say, however, that raising your hat describes what you are doing. It merely makes it, constitutes it explicitly an act of homage. And so, putting I promise that at the head of the performative utterance makes explicit what act you are doing, and eo ipso does the act, but it does not describe it.
Austin came to doubt whether even ordinary statements of fact are always either true or false. He began to suspect that they too can be subject to happiness or unhappiness in the same way as performatives, for example, in the case of historical statements.
And so with Lord Raglan and the Battle of Alma. Alma, in case you didn't know, why should you, was what we call a soldier's battle, if ever there was one. Well, of course, Lord Raglan was in command. Ordinarily, he was in command of the British, though not of the French, and the French were supposed to do what the British indicated they would like them to do, and to a minor extent possibly did so. It happens to be true that none of Lord Raglan's orders were ever transmitted. Well, did he win the Battle of Alma? Not, of course, in some context. It's perfectly justifiable to say so. Something of an exaggeration, maybe. Of course, any question of giving the old fool a medal for it, that's rather a different matter. One wouldn't want to dwell on his having won the battle in that case.
What do you think really inspired Austin to all this? Just hatred of impressionism and hatred of, as you say, disorganized guesswork, and the fact that if you propounded a theory, the only way in which you could establish it was by looking at all the cases to which it might be applied, and considering having teams of people working concertedly in order to at least to dehydrate one piece of territory upon which we could stand. Dry land, this bit had been done.
Yes, done.
The word real, for example, had to be examined. I mean, this is a kind of central word.
Much yes.
Central than anyway. Well, then you had to painfully to go through real. When you say this table is real, what are you contrasting it with? Are you contrasting it with an hallucinatory table, hallucination of a table, or are you contrasting it with a table mountain, which can be called a table, but it's obviously not a table in the ordinary sense, or are you contrasting it with a toy table, or are you contrasting it with some other use of the word table, I don't know, multiplication table.
Yes.
That kind and so on. And although this seemed rather tedious, perhaps this is a rather Moore-like attitude, by which maybe we should be able to get to a great system in the end, but in the meanwhile, we must simply clear the ground of the undergrowth or the waterlogged condition into which it's got. And for God's sake, Can't we have a team of people working on this first, and then we shall have some dry land to stand on? From there we can proceed to the next point, but it's got to be done systematically and thoroughly, and the ground once won must be forever kept.
People could never make very general statements about the word real again if he'd had six Oxford College tutors working for 6 months on the word real. Then no one would dare say, given its body of evidence, yes, the sort of things I'm now saying about the uses of the word real or whatever, yes, other word is involved.
Yes.
They wouldn't dare do it anymore, yes, because it'd be this. And then gradually, why shouldn't it be like science? After all, it's taken people 40 years to discover how, and some of them men of genius, how a nerve impulse goes along a nerve fiber. Now they think they may know. Why should we, Austin would say, and I think he did say, but not with that example, why should we suppose we discover what the notion of reality is or the notion of truth by some sort of amazing shortcut?
Yes.
Not at all. We must get down to it. We must work away as people do in the laboratories.
Similarly, you see, for example, Wittgenstein talked about language games, you remember?
Yes.
And also said, games, very well, in that case we must consider, why is it a game? In what sense is it a game? Is it a game like football? Or is it a game like cards? Or what kind of game is it? Is it a game with, what about the rules of the games? Who establishes rules in the case of games? And who establishes the rules in the case of language? I mean, is this analogy to be pressed? How far?
Yes.
There are all kinds of games which differ from each other. Which kind of game is language, if it is a game at all? This seems to me, this is the kind of thing he used to discuss at his
head. Well, more than discuss, he actually got people
to
look up the different, yes, kinds of games and how rules, so that people just couldn't laxly say it's like rules of a game when you have rules of
language. He didn't want that pursues, did he? He didn't want just brilliant flashes.
The last thing he wanted.
Yes, he would say, what about Arabian trick track, which I remember, one of the rules of which was that if you cheated and weren't caught out, you could win. Was it a game? Was that a rule of the game? Or was it, on the contrary, a rule about rules? And in that case, were there analogies in language, were there analogies in thought?
Yes.
One of the things which Austin seems to me, although of course he was very fascinated by words as such, as Moore was too, before him.
Yes.
And this sometimes led him into mere grammar and mere philology.
Well,
he checked himself, undoubtedly did.
Yes.
Undoubtedly did. Nevertheless, I think what he was concerned with, and what everybody who did this kind of thing was concerned with, was of course the nature of human thinking. I think they, philosophers of that particular school did themselves no service when they spoke about themselves as linguistic, because that conveyed the general impression that they really were interested in language for the sake of language. They weren't.
Austin was, you know. He really loved reading the dictionary.
Yes, I know, but this wasn't the program.
It wasn't the program,
but his objective is absolutely true, yes. And therefore, it sometimes wandered off into mere study of language. I agree, it became rather uninteresting except to those who were interested. But the program, the desire, so to speak, was to the old philosophical desire to examine, in some sense, structure, if there was a structure, at any rate, ways in which we thought about things.
Yes, but not to publicize any conclusions or utter any conclusions until one really covered the ground systematically. I think he really believed
No, but he
that.
Thought we thought in words. He thought we thought in symbols, and unless we attended to the structure of the symbols, we would never know what
of course,
was.
Of course, yes.
No, but this
yes.
has been said, you see, because after all, he and his followers have been accused of mere linguistic knowledge, which somehow was remote from the great concerns of the world, the great spiritual agonies into which people get, and this would seem to be a trivial word game of some sort, fiddling, while the world was burning in all kinds of ways. And it wasn't that. It was concerned with precisely the same problems as Aristotle or Hume or Kant were concerned with.
Yes.
Not different.
But there was a really different vision of... vision of what you could do in philosophy. He really thought you ought not to write about truth or the freedom of the will. I remember writing something about the freedom of the will and going to his class, which was always an enjoyable, amusing thing, and he produced counter-examples, and a lot of students, and we discussed them, and then I said to him afterwards, well, some of the counter-examples I agree with, some of them were rather invented, so to speak, they were freak counter-examples.
Mm.
And he said, oh yes, but that's the point, I mean, one wants to have the freak counter-examples so that everyone could see that you can't really systematize the field beyond a certain point. I mean, it is utterly spread out.
He was a very serious man, wasn't he?
Well,
he really was a very serious thinker.
Yes.
The great thing about him, it wasn't just fascination with his own skills. He was a serious thinker. Freedom of the will was a subject which I don't think preoccupied him, which undoubtedly was of interest to him. And he somehow believed that the arguments about freedom of the will by determinists and anti-determinists were mere theoretical games and weren't serious because he didn't believe that anyone really believed in determinism.
Yes.
He may have been mistaken about that. What he said to me was, it's all very well these people saying they're determinists. I've never met a determinist. I've never met anyone who behaved as if you were a determinist. I've never met anyone who used language as if he believed it. And I don't believe that anyone really has believed it. It's just a theoretical construct. Well, he may or may not have been right.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a very different approach from someone who's just pounces, you see what I mean, on any linguistic expression, no matter what, and applies brilliant techniques for its analysis just for its own sake. I want to convey that he really was concerned with solutions to the problems themselves,
yes,
and not the mere application, so to speak, of a technique which he thought really could draw anything up, so to speak. I think it's quite important to read, and that was the source of his moral influence.
And that is why he impressed...
Not his cleverness, but his intensity, and his extreme, if you like, moral seriousness about it.
Yes, yes. And he didn't think that was the way to, as regards the burnings in the world and the horrors outside, that the best thing...